Hello and welcome. Today we are hosting an interview with Doro prior to the separate listing of Careium in the beginning of December. My name is Rebecca Jadrup and I work as an equity analyst here at ABG and I am the one covering Doro. With me here today we have Jörgen Nilsson.
Thank you for having me.
Very, very welcome. You have been at Doro since 2015.
That is correct.
Yes. And you will become the CEO of Doro after the spin-off.
Yes.
Can you please describe the future for Doro? What will Doro be like without Careium?
Okay, sure. I'll be happy to. Well, basically, Doro started out. Started off as a consumer company, focusing mainly on consumer products. Then the last 4 or 5 years, our main strategy has been to grow within the care sector. And I think we've executed excellently on that strategy. We've acquired some companies, we've also focused a lot on development, etc., on care and grown heavily. Now we've come to realize that there are some opportunities and quite some possibilities that we've passed on the consumer side during these years. Obviously, there's been a transition from 2G, 3G, 4G, now 5G is happening as well. So it's been almost impossible to do all of that and focus on care at the same time. Big risk for overstretch. So now the shareholders, and I fully agree, see a big benefit of splitting the companies up, setting Careium on the stock market, and letting us going back to, let's take take advantage of all these opportunities that we have. So I would say, you know, you will see a consumer-focused, senior-focused, very innovative and very creative and passionate company, once again, like it used to be before.
Okay, but according to some research,
yep.
Feature phones, the market for that is declining.
Absolutely.
What is the future for Doro phones in terms of growth?
Yeah. No, you're fully correct. Feature phones have been declining somewhere between 5% and 50%, depending on region and country and segment, etc. But these are mainstream feature phones. That is a normal feature phone, basic, straight upside down. You have to remember, we work with senior feature phones. And although there is a decline in that too, that decline is significantly smaller. So from 2015 to 19, where we had no focus basically on phones, our CAGR was -1%. Then the last 2 years, because of COVID, we've had -2%. But this is once again during a period of 5 years where we basically have had the whole company either focusing first on smartphones and since 2015 and forward, basically just on care. So I wouldn't say we've neglected it because it was a strategy, it was a conscious decision, and we've executed excellently. But if you have a CAGR within a sector that people say is dying, which is -1% when you don't really focus on it, imagine what could have happened if we did focus on it. Mm. And then also last year we decided, in an effort to really push Careium to the top, we decided that, you know, let's walk away from some of these overstretch areas, some of the markets which are less profitable. For example, we have South Europe, etc., where the payment possibilities and the purchasing power is not the same. And when we did, the margin started going up. Excellent.
Mm. Yeah. It really has. The EBIT margin, for example, have raised from about 6% to 9% on a quarterly basis.
Yeah.
Since 2019.
Correct.
Can you tell me how has this been possible?
Well, number one is that we've actually walked away from some of these areas which were less profitable. As I said, when it was just 2G, if you put it that way, and there was a cost, but the cost wasn't so high. Once you went to 3G and then to 4G, and now we have something called voice over LTE, voice over Wi-Fi, all of these implementation are quite unique. I would even say not only from region to region, but from operator to operator. So if you want to do 4G, and you want to do it in North America, in Australia, in Europe, etc., there are heavy investments. So as a conscious decision, as part of the strategy we had for the whole company, we said, okay, let's focus on our main areas. It's DACH, it's Nordic, it's UK, and it's Frabel. And we spent the money there. Because of that, we stopped putting money into 4G development for North America, 4G development for Australia, etc. So that sliced out cost quite a lot.
Yeah.
Then we've also had a very beneficial development of product mix. We went heavy through all of our products and we looked, what products are we making good margin on? Let's use them and let's try and phase out the others. And then, let's be honest, there's been a very nice positive effect of currency too. So whoever is doing the stuff they're doing in the White House, just keep on doing it because it's good for us. But I mean, that's something, I mean, it's money in the house still, but of course we're very well aware that there is a currency effect.
Why were these markets less profitable that you were?
Well, as I said, there was a combination of. I mean, when you did 2G, but 2G was a voice-centric, very simple phone. It didn't cost much, and if you developed it for one market, you could basically sell it anywhere. For 3G, it became a little bit more complex. For 4G, and when it comes to voice over Wi-Fi, it's almost a specific implementation, not only per region but per mobile operator.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't want to go into North America or Australia, etc., it's a completely different implementation than Europe. And hence, you have to spend all of the development, all of the certification, all of the ISO, everything you have to do for a second or a third or a fourth part. So that increases the cost.
Okay.
Then also just to relate to that, I mean, if you take, for example, Eastern Europe, the purchasing power in, let's say, Bulgaria, Romania, Czech Republic or Italy, it is not on par with Western Europe. Like that, and our products do command a premium, and there's a reason for it, and our customers are willing to pay for it. But obviously, then if you have to sell them at that good premium in a market where the purchasing power is significantly lower, so that's, you know, it's a combination of factors, definitely.
Yeah. Okay. You also mentioned recently that you are broadening the range of technology solutions for seniors.
Yeah.
What does this mean?
What does it mean?
Well, yeah,
of course, I understand. Look, basically, I've seen a lot of analysts to tell you a feature phone is something of the past. It's not future phone, as some call it. It's dying, and it's basically just a phone with big buttons and a big screen. I understand that people think so, but there is so much more to it. I mean, when we talk about loud sound, yeah, of course, anyone can beef up the volume to 70 decibel. But if you imagine a normal phone, you have the speaker on the rear, and you have 70 decibel when you have it that way. But normally, people will face it with a screen upwards.
Mm-hmm.
And if a senior puts the phone down on a table, there might be some resonance from the table. But if you put it on a cushion or if you put it on the sofa, what happens to the sound?
Mm-hmm.
The sound is almost muted, but not on the door products, because we know seniors need to hear the phones. So then our engineers, they create a dome or a tip or whatever. So it doesn't matter if the phone is facing upwards or downwards, you still get the same sound.
Mm-hmm.
Same with boosting the sound volume. Of course, if you just increase all the volumes, it'll be a higher sound for you and me. But for anyone who's a senior, it still sounds as bad, because it's only certain frequencies in your ear that needs to be boosted.
Mm-hmm.
So with that detailed knowledge, I could probably talk for an hour about all these details, but with all that detailed knowledge that we have within the phones,
mm-hmm.
we see, why don't we apply that to other adjacent businesses?
Mm-hmm.
My favorite example was this summer when I got a new TV. My son-in-laws, they were bullying me. You need to get a new TV. So I got a new TV. It's a fantastic state-of-the-art TV, but I can't get the bloody remote to work.
Okay.
There's not a single key on it, and I'm only 50. And then I started thinking, okay, so a smart TV, a smart watch, a blood pressure meter, etc., etc. Couldn't we apply this 40 years of experience, of know-how, and also all the connections we have with all our suppliers in Asia? I mean, during all these 2 years of COVID, you know, there's been massive challenges with components and shipping.
Yeah.
But not for us.
No.
We'll be continuing delivering. How? Well, one of the main reasons is because of these long, very close ties that we have with our Asian partners. So if you take all that know-how, you take the experience, you take the fact that we really know the pains and the pleasures of the seniors,
mm-hmm.
why should you limit that to phones only?
Mm-hmm.
And over these last 40 years, Dora has made, we make phones, we make remote controls and a lot of other stuff. But we've also been approached several times during the last 5 years by, potential partners who said, couldn't we take our product, put a Dora logotype on it, and make it a senior? Because they don't want to be associated with seniors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
During the last 5 years, that was not part of our core strategy. So we chose to decline. Now we see a great opportunity to explore again.
Okay. Okay. Oh, interesting.
Mm-hmm.
My final question, actually, is... according to you, why is Doro a good investment?
According to me, why is Doro a great investment? Well, I would say, number one, the experience. 40, almost 50 years of experience of doing this. Really knowing the pain points and the pleasures and, you know, whatever makes seniors tick. So we do know. And as I said, it's so much more than most people just think it's a senior thing. We also have this realization. I think for you and me, it's hard to imagine, even fathom what it's like to become a senior. I don't have it with me, but I mean, we work with special gloves designed by Cambridge University. You put them on,
mm-hmm.
and your hand becomes a 75-year-old hand. Then you try and pick up a smartphone and hold it. You'll see how easy you drop it.
Mm.
So there's so much know-how behind it. You take that, you combine it with the experienced people we have, who for 45 years have been designing, producing, shipping, marketing, and selling over 300 direct sales points we have with all the major mobile operators, all the major retailers throughout Europe. That's an immense strength. Combine that then with our brand, the strong brand that we do have and the strong brand recognition we have within seniors. And also the fact, and which is kind of amazing, that our end customers, they are willing to pay a premium for our products. Our customers, the retailers, this, etc., they know they get a better earning, a better margin placement. So we take this, we apply this to adjacent technologies, adjacent portfolios. That's why we see the future.
Yeah. All right. Great answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you
for this interview. And thanks everyone that were listening.
Thank you.
Thank you.